Good morning. Good morning. Good to see you all on this absolutely beautiful summer's morning. And you're all very welcome. Yesterday, of course, we had our special memorial service for Jonathan Bardon, followed by a celebration for Jonathan. So I'll be saying a little bit about that later on during my sermon. And however, I would like to today take the opportunity to wish the Prime Minister Boris Johnson and Carrie Symonds all the best for their future with their marriage yesterday in Westminster Cathedral. And I know some people are thinking, am I wrong in assuming this, that some people maybe are not thinking, which Westminster Cathedral? Well, it's the Westminster Cathedral, the red brick building on the way to Victoria Station. Do people know it? It's the Catholic Cathedral in London on the way to Victoria Station. Now, I've been blue in the face telling people since Boris Johnson became Prime Minister that he is, in actual fact, the first Catholic Prime Minister of the United Kingdom. And they would look at me and go, Boris Johnson's not a Catholic. Yes, he is. Boris Johnson was baptized a Catholic in New York. His mom, Charlotte, a well-known painter, had all her children baptized Catholics. Hence the reason Boris got married the other day in Westminster Cathedral, the Catholic Cathedral. The only thing that puzzles me, and we may find out, is Boris is a divorced man. And I'm not sure how, as a divorced man, he would have got married in a Catholic cathedral, other than he had his... Was he married twice before? I think he was. Maybe they had both marriages annulled, that he didn't know what he was doing at the time, which is grounds for annulment. Anyway, I'm sure we'll read all about that. But once again, congratulations to the Prime Minister and Carrie Symonds. And may they have a long and wonderful life together. The other bit of good news, I was delighted to see two very fine sportsmen, Andrew Trimble and Oisin McConville. Oisin McConville is a very noted GAA football player. And Andrew Trimble, as we know, is a very noted rugby player. And both of them have clearly come out and identified that one of the important answers to all the issues here in Northern Ireland is integrated education. So well done, Oisin, and well done, Andrew. Absolutely coming out and saying that when they went to school, they never met anybody from what we call the other side, them ones. And I think this is wonderful that two people like that, Oisin and Andrew, have made that their cause and have made a public statement about it. So I'm delighted to hear that. Spirit of life, we pray for healing. Spirit of life, we pray for the healers. Spirit of life, we pray for closeness in our hearts. Now may we say together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. I have selected for the first reading two very, very short poems by one of my favourite poets, Czesław Miłosz, who I've read here before. He seems to have a poem that suits everything. And in the last year during lockdown and the pandemic, many of you will feel as I do that we were so lucky to live in Belfast, so near the Lagan Valley Park, where you can just wander for miles and discover new things all the time. And I absolutely love it, and I live very near it, but if I could, I'd live in it. And it's all about the river and the trees and the birds and the little places that you find, no matter how well you think you know it, and you stumble upon other little places that you hadn't seen before. And so the two poems that I've selected, one is called A Meadow, and I want to rename it Moorland's Meadow because that has become perhaps my favourite place on earth. And the second one is called For the Birds, Magpiety. So, A Meadow. It was a riverside meadow, lush from before the hay harvest, on an immaculate day in the sun of June. I searched for it, found it, recognised it. Grasses and flowers grew there, familiar in my childhood. With half-closed eyelids, I absorbed luminescence, and the scent garnered me, all knowing ceased. Suddenly I felt I was disappearing and weeping with joy. Now, the second little poem, I have a few friends who love birds in their gardens, but they hate magpies. And I like magpies because I like crows of all descriptions, and I like seagulls, and I like all birds that have an attitude. I like the loud birds. And I know they're predators, and that's why people hate them, but nature has to have predators. That's how the system works. And so that's what appeals to me about this poem, Magpiety. The same and not quite the same, I walked through oak forests, amazed that my muse, Mimosyne, has in no way diminished my amazement. A magpie was screeching, and I said, Magpiety? What is magpiety? I shall never achieve a magpie heart, a hairy nostril over the beak, a flight that always renews just when coming down. And so I shall never comprehend magpiety. If, however, magpiety does not exist, my nature does not exist either. Who would have guessed that centuries later, I would invent the question of universals?
Thank you.
Sorry, Eve, could I disturb you? See the book there? Thank you. Cheers. Thank you. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, God of love, God of wisdom, God of compassion, God who includes all of his beloved creatures. Heavenly Father, we have wintered enough. We have mourned enough. We have oppressed ourselves enough. Loving God, grant us to be free. Heavenly Father, our souls are too long cold. Our souls are too long buried. Our dreams have been hidden away, forgotten. Help us to bring our dreams back. Our hopes have been unheard. Give us hope in our hearts again. Loving God, we are waiting. We are waiting to rise again. In this, compassionate God, the season of steady rebirth, we awaken to the power so abundant, so holy, the return each year of the flowers, the leaves, the birds. Bring us closer to them. Bring us back into connection with our surroundings, with our friends, with our communities. Compassionate God, help us to find our hearts again. Help us to find our good spirits again. Help us to love again. Help us to believe again, to wonder again, to feel again, to feel all the love that is around us, to enjoy each other again, to touch each other again. We understand that the flow of life moves ever onward in good ways and in bad ways, in ways that we do not understand, in ways that divide us from each other. But we have arrived at our fateful spring. Help us to reconnect each with the other. Bless us with the humility to be forever grateful for all that we have received. Amen. For the second reading, I've selected sonnet number 116 from William Shakespeare. I'm not a great reader of Shakespeare, so bear with me as I read sonnet 166. Now, the reason I selected this piece is, you may recall, or you may not recall, but on the 8th of December 2020 was an amazing day, not only in the United Kingdom, but throughout the whole world. It was an amazing day. Can anybody remember why the 8th of December? No, okay, I will tell you. Because on the 8th of December, Margaret Keenan, 91, received her vaccination. And she was the first person in the world to receive a vaccination against COVID. Now, I know that you're going to say, well, hang on, there were all these people who volunteered for tests and so on and blah. I'm talking about the public personification of a person receiving her vaccination. Margaret Keenan, 91, received her vaccination against COVID-19. And she received it at 6:30 in the morning on the 8th of December, 2020, at University Hospital, Coventry. And Margaret comes from Northern Ireland. So the first person in the world officially to receive her vaccination came from Northern Ireland. Is the world aware of that? Well, they should be, even if she did get it in Coventry. Now, I know with the best will in the world, the media, and I don't think there's such a thing as a generic media, but the media tried to report a story as best they can. And a major newspaper in the Argentine, now this is all still connected, bear with me. A major paper in the Argentine yesterday reported that it was so sad to hear of the death of William Shakespeare. And after all the wonderful things he wrote, that it was really sad to hear that the other day, 2 days ago, in England, William Shakespeare died. Now, they were half right. Like a lot of stories you read in the paper or hear on television, they're half right. Indeed, William Shakespeare did die 2 days ago. And he was William Shakespeare, aged 81, who was, can anybody remember? He was the first man in the world to be vaccinated against COVID-19. William Shakespeare, aged 81, died yesterday from a stroke. And I hastily add, the stroke had no relationship at all with the fact that he got the COVID injection on the 8th of December, 2020, just after Margaret got hers. So he died, and the Argentinians kind of got the story wrong. They got William Shakespeare, the man, first man in the world to be vaccinated, confused with William Shakespeare, who was a bit of a writer. So for all the Argentinians out there, I would like to read sonnet number 116 in memory of William Shakespeare. Let me not to the marriage of true minds admit impotence. Love is not love which alters when its alteration finds, or bends with the remover to remove. Oh no, it is an ever fixed mark that looks on tempests and is never shaken. It is the star to every wandering bark, whose worth's unknown, although his height be taken. Love's not time's fool, though rosy lips and cheeks within his bending sickle compass come. Love alters not with his brief hours and weeks, but bears it out even to the edge of doom. If this be error, and upon me proved, I never writ, nor no man ever loved. Sonnet number 116 for the people of Argentina. Before I start my sermon, I'd just like to remind people, members of the congregation, that our AGM is on the 13th of June, Sunday the 13th of June, and will follow our service. That's Sunday the 13th of June. Now, yesterday we had a wonderful Thanksgiving service here in the church for Jonathan Barden, and Jonathan was a much loved member of the congregation, and delighted Carol is with us here this morning. And I have to say, one of the most exciting things for me yesterday was having Michael Longley in the pulpit. I was wowed by that completely. Michael Longley is my all-time favorite poet and one of my favorite people. He's an amazing, amazing man. And it was such a blessing for me to have Michael here speaking. And he spoke so profoundly. I remember one time Isabella and myself were shopping in Tesco's on the Lisburn Road, and Isabella spotted Michael walking along with his shopping list. And we were wondering, does his shopping list rhyme? Does he scan his shopping list? I wouldn't be a bit surprised. Or is it profoundly brilliant, his shopping list? Probably. But back to Jonathan, because Michael was a great fan of Jonathan. And by the way, the service has been recorded. Thank you to Alan and Alistair. And I think it's already up on YouTube. But Jonathan was a Renaissance man, really. I mean, he touched everything. He had a wicked sense of humor, and yet at the same time he had this great passion for history and for aspects of Ireland. And he loved the wild. He loved fishing, and he loved Father Ted. And of course, yesterday, Trevor was just about to play the theme music from Father Ted when the piper started. So Trevor will play it for us this morning, because the theme from Father Ted is Songs of Love, written by Neil Hannon of Divine Comedy, that wonderful, wonderful singer and composer, Neil Hannon. And showing what a small world it is, Neil Hannon's father was a Church of Ireland bishop, and he was Trevor's bishop. So there you go. So it's only just that you get to play it, Trevor. But one of the poems read yesterday was A Wishes for the Cloths of Heaven. Now, I hastily add, I may have pronounced A incorrectly. It's A-E-D-H, A Wishes for the Cloths of Heaven. Now, I did check that on Google. You know when you can check the pronunciation of a word? And A is a Celtic word. But you see, the problem was, and I'll talk a little bit later on, there wasn't only one A, there was two A's, and I'll explain that to you. And then there's the other problem here as well, that myself and Isabella keep getting corrected, is that you guys have, we call Donegal Irish, and you can keep it. We have Munster Irish, which is beautiful, and you're not getting it. And quite honestly, it's just as well we all speak English, because you could never understand each other if you speak Ulster Irish or you speak Munster Irish. To give you an example, when we want to say, how are you in Munster Irish, we say very politely, Conas Ata Tu. Conas Ata Tu. How are you? But up here you say, Cadjay Marata Tu. Now, how could a Munster Irish speaking person even begin to understand that? I don't know. However, that's what confuses me. A-E-D-H I would pronounce as nearly like egg. Nearly like egg? Egg. But here it's called something else altogether. A wishes for the cloths of heaven. Eventually, I think it ended up, he wishes for the cloths of heaven to make life easier. And I'll read, it's a short poem. And it was much loved by Jonathan. Had I the heavens embroidered cloths and wrought with golden and silver light, the blue and the dim and the dark cloths of night and light and the half light, I would spread the cloths under your feet, but I, being poor, have only my dreams. I have spread my dreams under your feet. Tread softly, because you tread on my dreams." The beautiful words of William Butler Yeats. A was a Celtic god. He was the Celtic god of death, and he was one of the children of Lear. And the four children of Lear are legendary in Irish mythology and are sometimes commemorated, you'll see, in Celtic wedding rings. Lear's second wife turned A into a swan, and that is one of the swans that Isabella and myself see regularly on the Laggan. And not to be confused, A is not to be confused with A, or Egg, who was the king of the Scots and the Picts from 877 to 878. Pronounced, as I discovered yesterday, pronounced Ed in Scotland, and sometimes Id in Northumbria. Whereas I would have been going around saying Egg. So there you go. But then he was a different Egg. Oh, that's, yeah, he was a different Egg. Yeah, that worked. That was unplanned. The poem was written by William Butler Yeats and is one of Ireland's most revered poems. And what is he referring to? Is he referring to the sky when we say, look up into the heavens? Rather than the religious idea of heaven, but when we look at a dark sky at night and see the stars and say, oh, just look at the heavens. And we mean it in a secular way. The various references to light and blue and dim and the dark clouds of night are just that. The writer has created a stunning image for the reader. And that image is the nightlight. The speaker now has conjured something beautiful that he is inviting, we presume, because it's William Butler Yeats, who's pretending to be Egg, because he has Egg saying the words, who really is William Butler Yeats. The speaker now has conjured something beautiful, and he is inviting, we presume, a woman to step on the cloth that he would of his dreams. And as I said, Yeats has put A, or Ed, or Id, speaking in his place. He then expresses, strangely enough in the poem, how poor he is, and asks that only he can only spread his dreams before this woman, and to tread softly on his dreams. Now, in my opinion, dreams can be anything from what our mind produces when we are asleep to our imagination of what we see as heaven, or what we see in even in a utopian or in a loving way. The poet, through a third party, is expressing, I believe, what he dreams of and giving his dreams are laying them in front of a person he loves. The dream thing can, of course, be of interest in another way, when dreams can be another person's nightmare, when people think of dreams that they conjure up to change the world and turn out to be a nightmare. The poem was published in the year 1899 in Yeats' book, The Wind Among the Reeds. Yeats had a very symbolic style, so the use of words like embroidered and inwrought suggest a luxurious, lavish tone as he's describing what he regards as the cloths of heaven. And in a lot of Yeats' poetry, there is an awful lot of symbolism. I suppose in today's parlance you might say, if I had a Bentley or a Rolls, I would drive you to the restaurant shoe. But I, being poor, have only a Volkswagen, so you'll have to settle for the chipper. That's probably how I would write it instead of Yeats. But then I'm not Yeats. A could be someone who finds beauty everywhere, but as he reveals those things of beauty, they might be rejected. Isabella spoke about the beauty of the Lagan Valley, and its astounding place, and how someone might find beauty there and others might reject what they sense as beauty. They might think what it really needs is a motorway going through it, or high-rise apartments all alongside it. And in that way, that's what Yeats is trying to get across through the character of A, the mythical Irish Celtic character of A, is that his dreams, what he regards as his dreams, what he regards as his things of beauty, could be rejected by somebody else. Like rejecting a gift. When somebody rejects a gift, and when you reject a gift, it's of no value to the giver. The giver stands there with something that is rejected, that wasn't for him or her, but was for another party, which they thought would be loved, would be a good example of rejecting somebody's dreams. Generally, William Butler Yeats was always going on about unrequited love. And it's a common theme in all his poetry. Actually, I think he was in love with being rejected. I had a friend like that when I was growing up, one of my closest friends. He always sang songs about women rejecting him. And I think he would have been very unhappy if a young girl had said yes, she would have loved to have been his boyfriend. That would have destroyed it, because he loved just singing, "If I were a carpenter and you were a lady." He just spent his whole life singing songs about girls rejecting him. I think he thought it made him more attractive. It didn't? I think I heard that. And I think that's why Yeats is the A in the poem. And the other that he's laying the cloths of heaven in front of is none other than Maud Gonne. And Maud Gonne just rejected him over and over again, never returned his love. And yet he was forever declaring his love for her. As a matter of fact, Maud Gonne married a chap called Captain John MacBride, which wasn't a great idea, because he had fought in the Boer War, on the Boer side, came back, and then I think he was in the GPO in 1916, he was around there, but he got shot anyway. So that didn't last too long. And she did feel about Yeats that if he wanted to marry her, he would have to convert to being a Catholic. Maud Gonne was a super Catholic, and she felt that Yeats would have to become a Catholic. Also, she was a very much firebrand nationalist, and she would have, and he was through his poetry, but that wasn't sufficient for her. She also told Yeats that he shouldn't marry because it would rob him of his genius. He was better if he was the lonely poet, that it made him more attractive. Back to my friend, if I was a carpenter and you were a lady, that somehow women would find him more attractive if he was this lonely, heartbroken poet that couldn't find any love anywhere. Well, now that was what Maud Gonne was saying to Yeats, but he really wanted to marry her. There is speculation that Yeats picked A because he saw in this character in The Children of Lear who was turned into a swan. And if you'd let someone turn you into a swan, well, then, you know, you'd want to think again. So he saw him as weak, and he had him as the speaker of the poem. He saw A as a pale, sensitive, Keatsian romantic figure of a poet. Yeats admitted some of this himself. He admitted, according to one of his biographers, that this poem, he wishes he had the clouts of heaven. Yeats admitted this himself. Was the way to lose a woman and not get a woman. He's having written the poem and seeing it as one of the world's most beautiful poets, he admitted later on it was the best way to lose a woman. And there, Yeats's own words. So, in a way, poor Yeats, he could never get the woman he loved, and there were many. Maud Gonne was one of many. Now, however, people have used his love poetry all the time. They give each other books of Yeats' poetry. So his poetry is used for every romantic occasion you can imagine. And I've been heard, I wouldn't know this, it's the way to a woman's heart is true Yeatsian poetry. Maybe somebody could inform me if that's true. But yet it wasn't for poor Yeats himself. Now, he did marry eventually. He married Georgie Hyde Lee, whom he met at the British Museum. And I presume he spread his dreams under her feet. And I take it she tread softly on his dreams. And they were happy ever after. Amen.
Two. when you're weary, feeling small, when tears are in your eyes, I'll dry them all. I'm on your side. Oh, when times get rough and friends just can't be found, like a bridge over troubled water, I will. When you're down and out, when you're on the street, when evening falls so hard, I'll comfort you. I'll take your part. Oh, darkness falls and pain is all around, like a bridge over troubled waters, I will lay me down like sail on, silver girl, sail on by. Your time has come to shine. All your dreams are on their way. I'm on your side. Oh, when you need a friend, I'm sailing right behind, like a bridge over troubled waters. I will lead your mind like a
Thank you, Brian. Thank you, Trevor. And thank you, choir. May the Eternal bless you and protect you. May the Eternal smile on you and favor you. May the Eternal befriend you and prosper you. Amen. God bless you all. Go in peace.